Right. Oh, I hope you had a good night's rest this night after the pub quiz. We really enjoyed making this and presenting this, so. And we are very happy you enjoyed it as well. So for the online audience, please join us next time. There may be another pub quiz. We're starting today with two morning sessions, which also include some of the online presenters. So we do hope technique will be helpful in this. The first speaker for now is here, Vasily Kati. I may call her Kiki, and I think you may call her Kiki as well. She will be talking about conservation in especially Greece and the case of Chotippus lacustris, the dancing grasshopper. Kiki, please, the floor is yours.
Hello, everybody. I hope this works. I feel like a TED presentation. I'm going to do movements. What to talk about? First, it's not going to be a research presentation. I'm going to talk about the Natura 2000 network and that the tools that we have at disposal as insect ecologies. And then I'm going to talk specifically for environmental impact assessment studies, that it's a huge field, and about Chotippus lacustris as a small case study. Okay, so we are all familiar with this, about the Griad variety, the astonishing variety Europe has about grasshoppers, and that we still have a huge degree of endemism, but also a Griad proportion of species that they are threatened, much more than other insect classes such as butterflies or dragonflies. Okay. So what is this Natura 2000 network? Many people are familiar with. European Union is very proud about it. It's the centerpiece, the cornerstone of the European nature and biodiversity policy. It has about coverage of 18% of EU, covering 27 countries, not like right now. Okay. It gives protection to several habitats and species. And of course, there are the two directives, the Habitats Directive and the Birds Directive, that the network is relying on them with the different annexes. Here is the map from the last barometer of the December 2020. It is almost 18% we are approaching. You can see here that, okay, I cannot show, but anyway, we have the sites of conservation interest, that they come from the Habitats Directive and the SPA, sites for special protected areas for birds, that they are coming from the Birds Directive. And the most important issue is that according to the recent European Biodiversity Strategy, this network has to be expanded and reach 30% of the land of each country and another 30% for the marine environment. Has it succeeded to harm biodiversity loss? This is a big question. Well, no. This is the simple answer. You can see here, I cannot show very well with this one, but anyway, we have, first, we have 62, if you can see in this pie, of species that are in unfavorable conservation status, that means the orange and red. And you can see also that there is a very small proportion of habitats, only 9%, and only 6% of the species that they show an increasing trend. Okay. And the situation is similar for arthropods. We have about 130 arthropods, more than 400 assessments they have been made. So 60% about of the arthropod species, they are in unfavorable, bad, or unfavorable inadequate, that means orange or red assessments. Here is the recent fitness check of the directive. So it was agreed at public consultation, and people, they have talked about if the Natura 2000 has succeeded in its aim or not. Here are some results. In essence, The money are well spent. We have life project. We have agreed at a huge conservation endeavor. But and it is a consensus that without the Natura, the biodiversity loss would be much greater than now. Okay. But the main problem is that the network lags behind in implementation. We have problem in implementation. For all us entomologists, it's a very poor representation of our arthropods in habitats directive. In practice, arthropods are only 99% of the European Union protected species. And according to the paper of Cardozo, you can also find here that the arthropod species in Europe, for instance, in Orthoptera, we have about over 1,000 species. And we have a very tiny proportion of 1% that is represented in the European Habitat Directive, in the annexes. So we do have a problem of underrepresentation of grasshoppers in the European Union Directive. This is the introduction. Let's see now what are the tools, the real tools, direct or indirect, that we do have to promote conservation of Orthoptera in Europe. So I have written here that 11 species, so maybe I'm wrong, it's 12, okay, maybe I missed one species, but anyway, we have these Orthoptera species that are annexed in the Habitats Directive. They cover 7 biogeographical zones that you can find here on the map. And about 70% of Orthoptera assessments are poor. That means that these species are red, bad conservation status, or orange, that is inadequate conservation status. So it's not good, the situation. Most of the species, they have a stable trend, population trend. So the first message to the floor is that we need to have conservation action for these annex species, because the Habitats Directive, they give to people, to scientists, the tool to proceed to the conservation of this tiny fraction of the vertebrates, because these species, they can function as umbrella species for the conservation of other grasshoppers that they are not listed in the Habitat Directive. Here is a short review of the species with the images, and you can see here the conservation status they do have in the different biogeographic regions, what is known so far from the last reporting of the member states. And you have species such as Baetica ostulata, that it's an endemic in Spain, very restricted conservation status. But you also have other species that they expand in different biogeographic regions, and you can find them in several Natura 2000 sites. Here is the number of Natura 2 sites that they are designed for the species. So we do have some tools to continue. And for instance, Paracaloptenus caloptenoides, I just take it as an example. Its conservation status is near threatened for Europe, but it's vulnerable for the 27 member states. And you can find here in many biogeographical areas, in many Natura 2000, so you can use the Paracaloptenus as a target species in order to do conservation work for other species as well. Second message, it's about the key commitments. This is a new text. We do have the new biodiversity strategy. And it says that 30% of EU land should be under conservation, okay? So we should expand the network of protected areas. And 10% should be under strict conservation status, okay? So let's talk about what is the importance for grasshoppers. First, it's not an expansion of the Natura 2000 network. It's not used the term Natura 2000. It's the term protected areas that it's used. It is a more flexible approach. The directive gives room for non-annex species to be considered for the expansion of the network of protected areas. So grasshoppers can be used, even if they are not protected under the Habitats Directive. And why I say so? Because we have here a very new document, the Commission Staff Working Document, Criteria Guidance for Protected Areas. It was published just 2 months ago, and it makes use of the IUCN Red Lists, very important tool we do have also for grasshoppers. So it makes a reference that we should use the Red Listed species to make the expansion of the network of protected areas in Europe. And also it makes reference to key biodiversity areas, an excellent concept, very good for orthopterologists, because we use the threatened biodiversity, That means critically endangered, vulnerable species, plus the proportion of the global size extent. So with these two tools, we can easily include grasshoppers in the new network of protected areas the European Union is going to be expanded. So the second message is that red listed orthoptera species, endemics, can be used for the expansion of the network, but we do need to do a lot of policy work now with our national governments about this. So much information here, just to be simple. All these are the key commitments for European Nature Restoration Plan. Okay? So these commitments are going to be soon legally binding. Okay? So every member state should do it, should take action. And you have here a list about different habitat restoration targets that they are going to be very favorable for grasshoppers. And just take the examples. They talk about habitat restoration for degraded carbon-rich ecosystems, grasslands, shrublands, forests, wetlands. All these are targeted ecosystems to be restored in the European Union, and all these are habitats of grasshoppers. Or we have at least 25,000 kilometers of free-flowing rivers should be restored, yes, so we can have a habitat restoration for tetrix habitats and other Hygrophilus grasshoppers. And a very important initiative is the pollination, the pollinators initiative, something that grasshoppers are not considered to be, but because there is a lot of research of concurrent species resistance patterns, for instance, between grasshoppers and butterflies, we can use this initiative to restore butterfly habitats, grassland habitats, for the benefit of grasshoppers as well. Okay. I continue, more commitments, for instance, the pesticides. It's a commitment that it's very important because here you can see the main threats, okay, after the IUCN assessment of the main habitats. All these commitments about restoring agricultural areas. So it's very important for grasshoppers as well to restore high natural landscape value areas. And finally, also for invasive species that we should have a reduction. Of course, there are other important threats such as livestock grazing, urbanization, or land abandonment that they are not covered. Okay. Another issue is the life that we had yesterday, this excellent presentation. Before life, it was the main instrument of European Union for funding the conservation of the annex species and nothing else. But recently, this life instrumental tool, financial tool, can be used also for the red listed species. And this is especially the safeguard in our species subtopic that one can submit a life proposal and have a funding up to 60%. So it is an excellent tool. And it was presented yesterday, this very nice life project for the critically endangered orthoptera species, the crow-playing grasshopper. So it is an open field for submitting new proposals for the conservation of endangered species. Finally, I go to a more special case, the case of Hothypus lacustris. I would like to talk especially for the environmental impact assessment studies, okay, not in general for the ecology of the species. An introduction, it's a very beautiful little creature. We have a poster, we're going to be up if somebody wants to ask for more information during the coffee break. And okay, it has a very fragmented distribution. It has lost a lot of its habitat. We have done a lot of research in the past. There is a huge conservation endeavor for the species. It still suffers and loses population. And we try to help it. Okay? And it's famous for the sex dance, of course. And introduction. The great success of our country is that we have pushed the government a lot in order to have a legal frame for the conservation of the endangered and endemic species, horizontally, not only for grasshoppers. And this is a very good thing because we do have this biodiversity law that habitat destruction is illegal, okay, for endemic and for threatened species, any species, not only grasshoppers. Second, because of this legislation and because of the new biodiversity strategy that it's more open to red listed species, for the first time, the Greek government can fund projects on species that they are not annexed under the Habitat Directive. And I just give you some examples here. The last year, we have run 4 projects for the mountainous endemic species, and it's also a PhD starting of Mr. Stefanidis about it. And finally, we also had a project for lacustris, okay, for the conservation. So we make the best use we could of these new tools at national scale. After this introduction about the national issue, I go deep now to what happened here. It is quite critical, the situation, because all this is areas that they are lost, all this gray surface, they are humid grasslands lost. This is from a previous paper. And we know even the phytosociological community of the species and the habitat of the species. We know a lot, okay? So in the locality B, we have a new plan that is coming to build a hotel. ABC, the 3 different sections. Normally, the hotel could be built like this, okay? But because we have done so much conservation work with the management agency of the Natura 2000 of Panvotis Lake, because there are 2 Natura 2000 sites there, they said, no, we do not allow you to do the hotel. First, we need to have an extra appropriate assessment study. This appropriate assessment, according to the AIA directive, they should be delivered for annexed species of the directive only, okay? That any project can be done, but when there is no doubt at all that it's going to harm the integrity of the Natura 2000 sites. So the management agency uses the directive for the benefit of Hotipus lacustris, although it's not an annexed species. And unfortunately it happens that the investor, through a consultant company, assigned the contract to me, okay, because there is no other expert for Hotipus lacustris. And here is a result. So we made the survey in 2006. We can see all the points there, what we have done for the species to discover it. And here is the results. So it has a shift of distribution from the blue to the green area. And the results are terrible, really, because the species has lost 92% of its population and 26% of its area. So we go to a local extinction. Why? Very obviously, I'm going just to show you pictures because of debris deposit, illegal debris deposit. So it is at least 2 meters height of debris that was deposited on Gaskoupes, on lacustris habitats, in order to build the hotel, for not to have the humid substrate of the lake. And for instance, from these sides that I have the camera, I made the picture, so you can see the 2 meter height difference. And after a few years, there was no difference, because this 2 meter debris was expanding also to lacustris habitat. Okay, this is the type of huge interventions happening. And you can find here where, how it was the habitat in 2003, a picture, and then how it was the habitat in 2016, that it was no population anymore. Okay, so what our assessment has suggested is that you have to build your hotel in C, because there was no records there. You should restore the habitats in B by mowing and taking away the shrubs I showed you before, and debris removal and grassland refluting, habitat restoration, also in the first place, okay? Because also this habitat, it belongs to the Habitat Directive, to the first annex, and it's in a favorable conservation status. So that you have to restore this habitat, okay? What happened next? That's the question. They just didn't deliver this to the management agency, okay? They hide this. Okay, this special assessment study was never delivered to the competent authority to make a decision. I was thinking, and we were all thinking, that it's okay, that maybe the population could be saved in this area, because there was no action for several years. But then in 2021, it was a new appropriate assessment study assigned to a different scientist, and he said that it's okay because we can restore this 0.1 hectare, okay, because I was asking for 0.85 hectares to be restored, and we can make an artificial wetland, but this is, okay, quite ambiguous if this is going to help the species to recover or not. I do not know if such intervention is going to be in favor for the species. And the evolution is that the management agency, and to be more precise, the board of the management agency, not the scientific staff, it's the board who makes the decision, they decide for the hotel. So just a few months ago, they give a positive opinion for the hotel to be built. Okay. And nowadays, I would like also to say that after a couple of months, the board ceased to exist. I mean, that it is a board, it takes a decision and then it stops existing, but the decision has a legal importance. And then the local government of the Epirus gives also a positive opinion. So a forthcoming local extinction is to be expected. We're going to struggle more, but we don't know. I just give you this as an example of what is the conservation endeavor and what could be the result. It cannot always be positive. So some messages, what we can do. First, conservation action for this annexed Orthoptera species of the Habitats Directive. This is the first thing we can do. Second, use the Orthoptera red list species. We are very, very lucky and in a very good position that we do have the European red list assessment, which is quite recent. And we can use it for the expansion of the network of protected areas through the concept of key biodiversity areas. Four, we can use annexed habitat species of the Habitat Directive to protect Orthoptera. For instance, in Greece, we pushed a lot to have an action plan for a Habitat Directive species, a butterfly, the Parnassus apollo, because it is sympatric with many other mountainous grasshopper species. Okay, so there are also other ways to foster grasshopper conservation. Submit live proposals for red listed, increase knowledge, update maps, do distribution, make citizen science work. We need more information, especially for very rich countries that we don't have data, in order to build databases and to communicate them to the agencies and to governments, in order to stop perhaps harmful projects on grasshopper habitats and to foster conservation. And we need a lot of policy work with governments trying to push to promote legislation, perhaps in your countries to enter legislation for, to pass legislation for grasshoppers, in my country to implement legislation for endemics and Orthoptera. And communicate science to the broad public. Okay, so I don't know how much time I have. 5 minutes, okay, thank you. So, of course, we don't have to get disappointed, it's a long way. I would like just to close with this. I have just a few minutes to tell you that in collaboration with Luke and other people, we try to do some work on grasshopper conservation in Greece. First, we have this wonderful key of Luke, Roy, and Botwin, the grasshoppers of Greek. So I personally try to help a little by giving an open PDF of the translation in Greek for students to be for everybody. Second, very important, I try to make in GIS all the important grasshopper species we have for the Natura 2000 sites. I make an open database, very easy to visit, and I send letters to all the management agency of the Natura 2000 to say that here you are, these are important, here is the legislation, you should not omit grasshoppers from any decision you are making for your website, for your Natura 2000. This is quite important. A lot of research, okay, from different diploma theses and PhD theses that we try to build the new young generation of orthopterologists in the country, or taking research projects, or even training people in the Natura 2000 areas to do the monitoring. As you're going to see also in the Lacustis poster, this is the first management agency in Greece that is doing a monitoring project for insect species, and this happened to be Lacustris. And a good story, for not to say only the bad, is that for another project, harmful project, that it was a pipeline, a gas pipeline, on Lacustis habitat, they gave a negative opinion and it stopped. I mean, it was deviated, as it should be for any species. Okay. Big news, we have the Faraki Fund, okay? Maybe you all know about it. We are very happy about it. So it is an initiative from Luke Willemse and supported by many of us, so it's very nice, and policy work as well. And I would like just to stick that we have a huge, I think, huge conservation success in the country because we have the first roadless legislation. I know that this is not of interest for Central Europe because it's very fragmented landscape, but for all Eastern countries, Mediterranean countries, Balkan countries, we still have wilderness, we still have intact habitats in mountains, okay, without any human intervention. So in Greece, we managed to have a law for six large areas, large mountainous areas, Lefkaori, Olibos, Timfis, Molikas, the big mountains, and no road, no renewable energy infrastructure, no tourist, no ski center is allowed there anymore. And we continue and we push to give such strict protection conservation status to other mountains as well. So also science communication is important, TV, documentaries and all this. Okay, I would like just to give you some overview of what we're trying to do and perhaps also you are doing more, but I would like just to share this with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Kiki. There are some questions. This was really a very interesting and dense presentation with a lot of information. I think also, although some signals are not so nice, there are some really new tools to implement in our conservation work. So we have a lot of questions.
I would like just to say that I'm going to make this PDF available, so there are links, because sometimes it's different to find. You can click and you find all the European documents. That's why I make this. Okay, to be easy for you to find the documentation.
Okay, fine. So please state your name before your question.
Klaus-Jürgen Konze from Germany. Two questions. Do you think it's helpful to integrate lawyers in this fight? And do you think that to define grasshoppers also as characteristic for the habitats is a help?
The first question is if we can use people from the law, lawyers, okay? Well, I don't know how it works in every country. I mean, for instance, in my country, it was okay with scientists to push to have this, to make letters from different academics, from different departments, to say that we should include red lizard species. We should also make a consortium of people sending this. And this worked, okay? So it's just a law to say that all red lizard species is protected. We don't need some special juridical knowledge. Okay? And I think it's very simple, really. I mean, as a text, as a document in law. Do it. And the second is to talk about characteristic species and so on.
It's not from the end. In Germany, I think it's overall, and also in other countries, but you can define other species, not in the annex, as characteristic for the habitats, and then they are also to assess. Yeah.
Listen, I know that's why also in Germany you can have other butterfly species, for instance, but not grasshoppers. So my personal opinion is that if you use more democratic, equal term use for all species and to speak about term, I'm sorry, to speak about the IUCN critically endangered status, I think this horizontal rule is better. Because then you need a lot of scientific argumentation of what is typical, what is characteristic. It takes time, and we don't have time. Destruction is moving fast.
Hello. Axel Hochkirch from Germany. First of all, it looks like it is too late for this one population of lacustris now. Perhaps there's a last chance, I don't know. But sometimes we make intervention letters from the IUCN. And I wrote, for example, last year an intervention letter for a road project in Israel, which would destroy a cave with endemic species. And in fact, because it came from IUCN, the government then said, well, okay, we will stop this planning. So sometimes if there's international pressure, or then it may help. So if this is still helpful, we can arrange something.
Thank you.
And the second thing, I think it's very good to see that Europe is now starting to increase the network, the Natura 2000 network. And we had the initiative in the Grasshopper Specialist Group a few years ago to create something like a shadow list of Natura 2000 species, new Habitats Directive species, because they will not be added to the Habitats Directive earlier. They don't want to change the legal system. But if there is a list existing somewhere, it can help, because they would need some guidance for these new protected areas.
Can I say something? Yes, okay, just to comment that this work you have said, I already have done it in 2004 by the chair of the IUCN at that time, and with the signature of Otto von Harvesen and Fer Willems, I try also to do this international network for, to stop the destruction. And that will be very helpful to do it again. But maybe now it should not be me. It should be the management agency of the Lake Panvotis, because they are the competent authorities. So I hope that that will be very helpful. Okay. Second question about you talk about the shadow list. There are two things that they are currently ongoing. For instance, the Butterfly Conservation Europe gets organized because one of the first commitments is to improve the conservation status of 30%, at least 30% of the annexed species. So it is which species is going to be chosen. You understand? So maybe there will be all plant species and no grasshopper. But if we have some grasshopper species included in these pledges, they are working now in the policy about which species to target, to say that this species, it has a orange color, it should be green. Okay, let's do it in all Europe. Let's make action plans and implement it in order to improve the conservation status. So this is some work, some policy work of IUCN in Europe, maybe of you, I'm sorry, it takes a task for you to select some species and in order to include the pledges of the governments and to try to improve their conservation status. Okay, I would like just to say this for the annex species. And yes, for the non-annexed, yes, it's perfect that is the shadow list. For instance, the Peryonotropis could be some of them because all of them in a bad situation. Yeah. Okay, we are here to help anything.
Okay, so thank you. Josef Tumbring from Germany. I'm responsible in the Federal Ministry of Nature Conservation for nature conservation in Germany and Europe. So, and thanks for the very good summary what happens on the EU level, and only some remarks. So, in the German presidency in 2020, we negotiated the biodiversity strategy, so we know very well what happens. So the member states are now asked to pledge the 30% and 10% areas until the end of this year. The end of this year. So we have to be very fast. So there are a lot of ongoing discussions in Germany, I think in the other member states, what sites and so on. So, but it's the end of this year, maybe some months later. So the second remark is the restoration law. It's postponed. So we know what the EU will do, but it's postponed. But we hope it will be published in June this year. Mm-hmm. We hope it will be published in June. And I think it's a very good key for the future to restore a lot of sites. So, and it should be a law, a restoration law. So it's very helpful when we get it. So that's the second remark. And the third remark is, there is no discussion to change the EU Habitat Directive and the annexes. So there's no discussion. So maybe you can think about a new list of annex species, but there's no discussion for the next years. Thanks.
I would like also to comment, if I have time, I don't know, maybe not, but it was the greatest public consultation in Europe. It was in the fitness check of the Habitats Directive. So there were millions of European taking part. In the beginning, we all scientists wanted to change the annexes, okay, to make it more representative for several groups, to add more species. But we understood that the lobbies were so strong that if we open the habitats annexes will lose because many species will be out and no new species in. So that's why somehow from the policy work from several societies we understood that it's okay if we let the annexes as they are. So they cannot be changed ever because we don't know the output. Okay, this is the first remark. Second, thanks for noting this. It's very important. I think that on the pledges on the national level, we should do some work to include at least a couple of grasshopper species of the Habitats Directive as a commitment, national commitment to improve the eco-conservation status. Okay, so I do agree with you. And just to say that all this biodiversity strategy, it is legally binding because all nations, all member states, they should include it in their natural legislation. But what we expect to have is also the guidelines to say that exactly how you should do it. Some of the guidelines for the strict protected areas, it's already published and it's there. Okay, so sorry to take your time. I'm leaving.